Awesome. Yeah, where is everybody from? Let's get the whole list. It's fun to see. One guy's in Austria, Houston, Atlanta, Ohio, Arizona, Chicago, Minnesota, Canada, Vegas. Oh, a few Vegases. Hold on. My E-Trade Pro is disconnecting. I'm at a hotel and doesn't like my software. London, New York, Chicago, Miami, Manhattan Beach, Toronto, Slovenia, Corpus Christi, Boston, Arizona, Calgary, Austin, Boston, Delray, Holland, Netherlands, Minnesota, Boston. A lot of Boston people. That's cool. Unless maybe you're just saying it like over and over again. France, Iowa, Albuquerque. Cool. How's everybody? Mongolia. Wow. Are you serious about Mongolia? I love Mongolian food. So, yeah, today was a little bit of a slow day. You know, how did you guys do? I saw some people say they didn't trade, and that's fine. You know, you guys don't feel like you need to trade every single day. If there's nothing great, you know, you don't have to force trades. It's not a bad thing to not trade. You know, a lot of people think that, like, you want your money working all the time, but sometimes the best trade is no trade. And that is a very tough lesson for people to learn. And I'm glad some of you guys were studying, and that's awesome. Don't feel pressured to trade, even if there is a great play. You know, focus on your studying. Always remember, medical school students do not start operating on patients in month one or year one or even year two of their education. So I'm not saying you have to, you know, pay me six figures and give me 10 years of your time to learn this. But at the same time, just understand, you know, a lot of these skills and industries where you can really earn a lot, and it's kind of specialized knowledge, you don't get it all in a day. It's not about hot picks. And you guys watched Michael Good this morning. You got Mark Crook tomorrow. I mean, we've got you covered with all the webinars. And, you know, even Mark Crook, as he'll tell you, has problems sometimes with overtrading. You know, if you look at Mark Crook's profits, I don't know what they are now, but I did a study about a year ago, and 80% of his profits come from 6% of his trades. So just think about that. Jay Cordova made nearly 70 cents a share on DGLY. Awesome. Good job, Jay Cordova. I totally missed DGLY. I saw that was a nice spiker today. That was the recent supernova to dip by. I was dip buying BGI, which had a nice morning spike, but then did nothing, absolutely nothing all day. So I was buying the wrong one, basically a scratch. TWER, which I was buying yesterday, had another spike. In hindsight, I should have rebought, you know, in the 250, 260 region as it just touched 250, which was former support. This is what I love about penny stocks. You usually get multiple times to get it right. I know some people didn't see it spiking yesterday. It spiked 30 cents a share before I bought. And, you know, I basically piggybacked that because of Barry Honig, this professional promoter who owns 10% of the company. And I'm hoping that he has some big plans for this. But you never know. It's going to take news. It's going to take more volume. And you want to buy breakouts with volume, which happened here, and also dip buy when they hold support. And you can clearly see the top the other day was 246. The breakout yesterday was at 246. Today's low, 246. So it's, you need to, you know, look at these key numbers. It's very important for you to understand key levels. And I thought about it. I actually almost, I had a choice between dip buying TWER this morning or dip buying, or actually buying BGI on the breakout. And because I was a little disappointed that TWER did not have a press release today, And that means that Barry Honig is not, you know, planning his pump right now. I didn't dip by it. But as it turned out, this one did spike 50 cents a share. So it was a nice dip buy. So congrats to those of you who did that. Let's see. Oh, someone doesn't realize that I'm live. Yeah, you have to refresh. You have to refresh the webinar page to make sure that you see me live. Chart reaction says TWER was down red on the day and down from pre-market. You said in the past never to buy those. Yeah, so, you know, in this market, what a lot of people aren't understanding is that this market is very speculative and very aggressive. You know, when I was buying BGI at $1.20 and selling it at $1.50 roughly the other day, and it goes to $5. So you, the same day, so and within an hour. So you have to kind of be aggressive with spikers right now. You know, TWER, there was not any catalyst yesterday. So some people were confused. The catalyst for me was that it had already spiked. First of all, I'm not just buying random stocks, but it had already spiked. Barry Honig is involved, and this has a history of recent running. So those three indicators were enough for me to buy it. And, you know, sure enough, that worked well. Today, the price action was not good in the morning, but in this market, because we're being aggressive, look for support to hold. And you can clearly see, I mean, this is a pure perfect flat line right here at 244. The high here was 246, but the afternoon high the other day was 244. The morning high yesterday was 244. Today's low was really 245. So 244, 245, 246 are key levels. So I'm not saying, you know, buy it right here because there was no news. It would be tough to spot the breakout to a T. But I bought it in the 260 area. So I'm not buying it that far away from the breakout. And then when you have a stock that goes all the way to the threes, you know, it's not that bad to dip by. Remember VMRI the other day. I dip bought it. It was spiking, it was breaking out, and I dip bought it here at 215. Ignore this drop. This is just bad data. E-Trade Pro doesn't have the best data. I'm working on it with Stocks to Trade. Unfortunately, Stocks to Trade doesn't allow me to do webinars yet. There's some bug with Stocks to Trade and the webinar software. We're working on it. But I caught the bottom here on VMRI. And even though it wasn't necessarily a great risk reward trade, because I'm basically buying the first red day of a pump, and I kind of wish I didn't do that because it confused a lot of people, I was actually right. You know, it did go from 215 to 245, and I only took 10 cents a share roughly because I was so freaked out about it. But there are no exact rules. You have to kind of adapt to the market. So right now we are in aggressive market. You'll see me buying more. You'll see me not necessarily taking bigger positions, because even though I'm more aggressive with my buys, I'm still understanding that these are very speculative trades. So you see me buying like 2,000 shares of a $2 stock. But if I am right, I'm going to make, you know, like $1,000. So that's kind of the cool thing about this market right now. And I know a lot of you guys are just beginning. So don't feel bad if you don't know what's going on. It comes to you over time. There's a reason why I have nearly 4,000 video lessons. There's a reason why we do so many weekly webinars and stuff like that. Let me take some questions. This is a Q&A webinar, guys, so throw out your questions and I will answer them all. You have me roughly for the next 90 minutes. Let's see. So that was my answer on TWER. Even though it was red on the day, even though it was a failed morning spike, it did hold support at 245. So I'm not saying buy it at 270 or 280, but if you can buy it at like 250, you know, that's not bad. I saw Michael Good was actually shorting and he covered at 251. So he saw the support at 245 also. So he had a good cover on his short. I think he made like 200 or 300. Talk about REN. Yeah, so REN is one of these plays that I don't get because it's an energy play. You know, I specifically say in DVDs, do not trade energy plays because they can just keep spiking like this. They can keep going supernova, huge volume. It's not a pump and dump. No different than SGY, which is another energy company. And this has gone from 3 to 22. So for me, it's very important that you guys do pay attention to some rules. As I said, it's not an exact science, but there are reasons why I have rules. It's not an exact science, but it's not also totally random. So when I say I don't like energy plays, you haven't seen me play SGY. You haven't seen me play REN. You guys are looking at this chart, shorting it, and you're thinking that it's just going to roll over. It's not a pump and dump. If this chart was a pump and dump and not an energy play, and let's say it was just promoted for, you know, a few days by newsletters, when it starts to go red, when the volume starts to fade, when too much time has elapsed, then yes, it could roll over. But when it's energy, and as you saw from SGY, from the 3s to the 22s in a month or two, you know, all bets are out the window. So a lot of you guys are kind of throwing out all of the rules. When I say it's not an exact science, you're like, well, let me just do this anyways. There are some really good guidelines. You know, non-energy plays. Don't use market orders. Don't go short on a Friday afternoon. They don't work all the time. None of my rules work all the time, but it'll be in your best interest to pay attention. I don't just say I avoid energy plays because I like talking. This is something that I've learned over, you know, the past two decades. AVXL. So this is another one. Lots of short sellers love this one. They think that it's going to, you know, just die. And you've got a little bit of a drop, you know, from 8 to 7 over 3 days. It's so choppy, though. And what is another rule that I like to say? I don't like choppy stocks. So while, yes, you could make 20 cents a share, maybe 40 cents a share, too choppy for me. So I ignore it. This is what you guys have to learn about the stock market. You can tailor your experience to you. If you find a pattern that freaks you out or hurts your head or makes you uncomfortable or makes you sweaty, it's okay. You don't have to do it. You know, you really do not have to be a master of all patterns. Tim Grittani and I just celebrated his $3 million milestone. We gave a webinar, and one of his key points last week was that he only specializes in a few patterns, and it's perfectly acceptable, and in fact, not just acceptable, it's great to ignore plays when they are not your patterns. So do study all the patterns. You don't know which patterns you're going to like or not like. But at the same time, understand that you don't have to like buy a stock and then short it and take part in every part of the move. Try and figure out what suits your personality best. And frankly, this is why I have the most millionaire students, but this is also the gift and curse of trading. No two of us are alike. Just because I see a pattern and I see something that, you know, really suits my preferences does not mean that you will. And it doesn't mean that you're going to love it. So you have to be very, very careful. You know, that's all I can really say. Oh, let me turn down this. I hope I don't have an echo. Was there an echo this whole time? Good. No echo. Okay. I've done that a few times where I'm just talking for like 30 minutes and you can't understand a word that I'm saying because I forgot to turn off the sound. Let's see. More questions. I like them. Can you check EXAS? Why is the stock going down? They also have news. A lot of people hate on penny stocks and they say, why is the stock going down? They have good news. Don't try and judge the news. Focus on price action. Maybe because the stock is up so much, the news has already been priced in. I'm trying to think of a ticker. This was a few weeks ago. It was the same time, like the day before WATT got FDA approval, and I bought it because I thought it would spike right here, and it turned out to be the top. I cut losses quickly, but, or maybe it was here. Yeah, it was here. It was back in May. And WATT was a breakout above this level, and they had FDA approval, and the stock did nothing. And everyone's like, they just got FDA, or it was FCC approval, my bad. For their wireless charging transmitter. And everyone's like, why is this not breaking out? And some people were adding to the position, and they're like, no, the stock is wrong. The market is wrong. This news is huge. Well, eventually it did break out, but for nearly a month, you know, if you're buying it in the 11s, you're selling it in the 9s for a 20% loss. So don't try and judge. And there was a pharmaceutical company around there too. Was it ORMP? Oh my God, it was. Ha! ORMP got FDA approval here, and it just could not hold its gains. Maybe it was here. It was one of these in May. And everyone was like, why is this not going up? Because it was already priced in. You don't know what's priced in ahead of time. That's what makes the stock market so tricky. You know, if you know, if there was a list that the stock market would provide you every morning, oh, this stock already has all the good news priced in. It is, even if they announce good news, it's going to go straight down. The stock market doesn't provide you that list. Nobody provides you that list. There is no list. It's just a lesson that you have to learn. And you have to recognize that price action is paramount. Price action is king. So if the news is good and the stock is dropping, the price action is right. This would save pretty much every single penny stock investor from ruin if they understood this one rule. But the vast majority of people hate on penny stocks because the news is good, especially when promoters are promoting it, and the stock sometimes drops 30, 40, 50% in a day. And they're like, penny stocks are random. Penny stocks are manipulated. This makes no sense. It makes perfect sense if you know the rules of the game. If the news is good in a penny stock, and these are, you know, $8, $9, $10 stocks, so they're not true penny stocks. And so they drop a little. But I've seen penny stocks drop 90% in a day on good news as the insiders sell. You have to remember the vast majority of stocks trading at $1, $2, $3 a share are outright scams or shells, or the insiders know there is no way that they're going to succeed. So when they announce good news to lure in buyers, anybody who can sell will be selling. Sometimes you have a penny stock with good news and it spikes. You know, there are real penny stocks out there. SYNC, for example, when it spiked from $1.40 up to $3, when they became the main website software provider for AT&T. And this is a $100 million a year contract, which they basically won. They beat out against Yahoo. So this little piece of shit penny stock company won a huge $100 million a year contract. And guess what? The stock spiked and it's held most of its gains. In fact, today it had a nice little bottoming action. So certain good news is confirmed by price action. And you can kind of guess this when, you know, you have a massive contract with a massive multi-billion dollar company like AT&T and you beat out Yahoo. I mean, that's definitely good news. But these kinds of contracts and this kind of news is very few and far between for penny stocks. Most penny stocks have, quote, good news. And then in reality, there's something going on in the background where it's not really that good. So that was a long answer to your question. But it's important that you guys understand that, especially you beginners who don't realize how corrupt and manipulated these penny stock companies are. So Jocelyn says, how do you tailor your trades when you're traveling and the internet connection is not the best? Welcome to my life, Jocelyn. I've traded probably, I mean, I've been to 107 countries now. I've traded probably from maybe 80 of them, maybe 85 of them. I would say, you know, 80 to 85% of the countries that I've been to, I've traded from. Sometimes the Wi-Fi is just so bad. Sometimes there's been no plays while I've been traveling. But the vast majority of times I'm trading. One famous time in my mind, I was in Portugal and I was on a train and I had Wi-Fi at the top of the hill. And then when the train went to the bottom of the hill, I had no Wi-Fi and it was very hilly territory. So I was stupidly in a trade and I would have, you know, quotes working when we're at the top of the hill for a few minutes and then no quotes. So it was like a blind trade. I've done blind airplane trades where I've bought a stock or shorted a stock and I go on an airplane when the stock market is open and I have no Wi-Fi. This was a younger version of me. Now I've become more conservative. The trade that pushed me over $1 million, I was on a cruise ship on semester at sea off the coast of Asia, and I was actually trading the ticker Asia, ASIA, so I thought that that was, you know, a good sign. And the internet went out, and I had $1 million bet roughly on the stock, and I was freaking out, and there was nothing you could do because we're on a freaking cruise ship off the coast of Japan, I believe. And when the Wi-Fi came back, I had made, I think, roughly around 80 grand, and that pushed me over $1 million. That was stupid. So how do you tailor your trading? I would try to trade, but at the same time, I would really be focused on only the best patterns, like buying an earnings winner, buying a big contract winner like SYNC, shorting a pump and dump if you can find shares of like VMRI or GDE. I would not trade speculative plays like TWER or BGI. I would lock down on really reliable patterns. EXAS, I was waiting for the first red day. What do I think for tomorrow? So EXAS, I mean, has been in this multi-month just gradual run-up. I have no idea what it's going to do. You know, there's no real first red day. I mean, yeah, it's a first red day. Maybe it goes down. I don't know what to do with this. So this is an example of a pattern that I would just simply avoid. Quentin says, Tim, when did you start going larger on your share per trade? I found consistency but feared going big to grow my account. I mean, I've gone up and down every single year since my beginning. In good markets, I get more aggressive. In bad markets, I tighten my belt. This year, I started with just $12,000, so obviously that's going to affect my trading positions compared to my normal account size of $500,000. There's no rhyme or reason. You know, I don't go back to $12,000 because I lost all my money, and I didn't go back to $12,000 when I first started teaching because I lost all my money, even though a lot of people thought that I did, because in finance, you know, theoretically you have to manage more and more and more money to look more and more and more successful. And for me, as a teacher, I found that I'm a more successful teacher if I trade with a small account. So it's counter to what most people think. But for you, you just have to do what's comfortable. You know, don't feel bad if you're paper trading. Don't feel bad if you're not even trading at all. Don't feel bad if you trade 100 shares. Don't feel bad if you're trading 1,000 shares. Gradually increase your, or maybe not even gradually. Maybe it all clicks in one day, but over time, increase your position sizes as you get more comfortable. And only you can define what is comfortable. You know, you should never be scared to make a trade. And if you go on a losing streak, as I just did a few days ago, you start trading smaller. You start going back and reviewing DVDs. You're never too rich or too experienced to go back to learning about the basics. TJ the Trader, do you see any plays that you might have missed that could have been worth longing overnight? No, the play that I wanted overnight was the first red day on this pump GDEE, because I think that this is just absolutely going to collapse in the coming days, and I could not find any shares to short, and that stinks. But as I say in one of my music videos, no borrow, no cry. I did not see any good long, so I did not take any. Tim, in reference to looking at the charts, do you have an order that you look at for a company? First, you look at 1 minute daily, then the 30-minute daily, then the 100-minute daily. Oh, the 100 daily. Yeah, I mean, I look at all different time frames. There's no specific order. I'm just looking for a key level. Like when I was looking at a key level of significance. So TWER, I mean, yesterday when I saw it spiking, it was already at 270, 275 when I saw it. And I looked at, you know, the multi-day chart, and I saw that the breakout was 246 and then the morning high was 245. So I knew that 245-ish was a key level. And I only had to look back 3 days. If I look back longer, the charts are all screwed up because they did a reverse split, actually. Even 5 days are screwed up. So charts don't really help you with this one. But I knew that this was a key level. MGT, I was dip buying this in the mid twos, right in here. And I got a lot of hate, people saying that I was pumping it and that, you know, this stock was bound to go back to the ones. And I was like, well, maybe, but until it cracks this low of 225-ish, it's not going back to the ones. It can't skip over and go from 240 down to 150. On the way, it has to crack this support. And it never did. So I wasn't there, you know, for the $2 a share rebound, but I was right. And all of those people who said that this could not go up anymore were dead wrong. And on this one, you had to simply just look at the daily chart and see the support at 225. In fact, actually, on this day, on May 27th, it actually cracked 225, 230-ish. And guess what? They came out with a press release right then to like swoop in and save the day. So for me, even though this is a promoted stock, I don't mind, you know, buying it or dip buying it and thinking that it could rebound. Even if, you know, this whole little group of short sellers who think that no stock should ever go up, I don't care what they think. Okay. I look at charts. So look at multiple timeframes. Tilly says, how are your friends from Wall Street Warriors? Are they still on Wall Street? I have no idea, Tilly. One of them is in jail, and they were never really my friends. You know, I just met them for the show. One of them was dating George Soros, Sandra. Even when he had a wife, that was kind of weird. Gita Shamai, who claimed that he had turned $2 million into $100 million, total liar. He was arrested, I believe, in North Carolina, and he was just spending all of his hedge fund's money like an idiot, and he's in jail. So don't trust what you see on TV. Let's see. Tim, when you are trading, what are you viewing? The level two chart, or the level two or the chart? If the chart, at what time do you watch? 1 minute or 2 minutes? Yeah, so this is my basic setup on Stocks to Trade or E-Trade Pro. I have my chart, I have my level two, and I have my watch list. And I look at all three in conjunction. In level two, I'm looking at for every single trade. So I highly, highly encourage you to watch my Learn Level 2 DVD if you have not seen it. You need it. It's 6 hours of understanding and explaining what level two is all about. Steve Teo, someone says, Freddie says, how do you execute orders so quickly? Freddie, I'm always ready to trade. You know, like on BGI today, I bought it, but I knew I was a little chasing. I think I even said it in the alert. When it double topped here, I mean, it went up to like 298. I wanted it to break into the threes here on the second attempt, and it couldn't do it. It stopped out at 293-ish. So I got out in the 280s because it just, you know, this was a double top. So I was looking for it to do something. When it didn't do it, I'm out. When I did bought it here in the 250s, I was looking for it to bounce past 270. And when it could not, I was out. And TWER, I mean, yesterday, I wanted to actually hold it overnight. But the reason why I didn't, it already hit all my goals. So that's why I got out. So if a stock is not doing exactly what I want, I get out. If a stock hits my goals, I get out. Let's say TWER had spiked from, you know, I was in the 260s. Let's say it was hanging around the 280s into the close. I might have sold half, or I would have maybe even held the entire position because it would not have reached my entire goals. And theoretically, if it was closing in the 280s, it would be closing strong. So I would want to hold it. You have to react to price action. One guy even has a screen name of that. Whose screen name was that? Chart reaction. I like it. Steve says, what key indicators inform when a morning spike or any spike is going to fail? You never really know. You know, it helps when it's a former runner, like on TWER. I mean, this ran 50% a few days ago. BGI was probably my, you know, best buy alert ever. In the ones before it hit, you know, the fives just a few hours later. So I like buying former runners because they have a chance to re-spike. And again, there's this whole group of short sellers out there who like to short into any spike. And that's nice. It works the vast majority of the time. But all it takes is one spike to go truly supernova, and you see people blow up. You know, Tim Grittani had a giant loss on PBMD last year. I know entire other chat rooms got devastated by PBMD. And I refused to short that in the mid twos because, frankly, I was just scared. And I thought that it could squeeze more, and it went all the way to the six in the same day. And I know many, many, quote, astute short sellers who lost 30, 40, 50, 75, 100% of their accounts that day. No different than AQXP or more recently KBIO. Michael Good and I were both short on KBIO the afternoon of its huge spike. Right here. This day when it, you know, you can't really see it, but it went from basically 2 to 10 in about an hour after hours. And this is often used as an example of why you should never short sell penny stocks. But somehow Michael Good and I were each short, I mean, sizable positions. I think I was short like 10,000 shares. And I lost a few thousand bucks because we cut losses quickly. So I never, and I know, again, in other chat rooms, people who do not follow my rules or do not believe in my kind of, you know, you could say that they're cowardly rules. People who do not believe in trading cowardly, they got destroyed on KBIO and they lost $300,000, $500,000, $1 million. So I never know when the top is, but I am always respectful that any of these stocks can go truly supernova. All it takes is one bad trade or two bad trades to wipe you out. Your account, your confidence, your buying power. I don't want that. So I'm constantly guarding against that. And, you know, in this market, again, we've seen so many supernovas. I had no idea that BGI was going to hit 5 when I was buying it at $1.20 the other day. But did it surprise me? No. We've seen a whole bunch of supernovas in the past few months. Up stocks up 200, 500, 1,000% in a day. So on these low flow plays with huge volume, expect the unexpected. And that way, you know, you're never disappointed. Let's see. More questions. Is stock and when it's going to fail? I have no idea. You know, so many people think that they know when the top is. I know people who were shorting BGI in the twos and the threes, and they got absolutely destroyed. So when there's a huge spike like that, I have no idea. And that's why you see me gravitating more lately towards buying morning spikes than trying to short morning spikes, because it's a very dangerous game. Some people do it well. Tim Grittani does it well, but understand he's trading with a massive account. He can average in over several minutes, several hours, or even several days. Most of you guys have a few thousand dollars. So you cannot average in, and you cannot risk being down 50% on any one position, or 20% for that matter. Is Stock Promoter still a viable source for spotting pump and dumps? I don't use it. You know, I really think that the success of my educational business has created the single best resource for penny stock traders, and that is the chat room. You know, we have over 1,000 traders in the chat room every day. Everybody's talking about stocks in play. You really don't need to subscribe to promoters like you used to. Many of the promoters have sold their email list to other promoters. So it's not like, oh, this promoter is so amazing. It's gotten easier for you guys if you're a student. At this point in the pump, are you long or short bias on VMRI? Definitely short bias. You know, this is a classic number 6 from my Penny Stocking Framework DVD. I know the DVD is a few years old, but the pattern works to a T. And when I was shorting it the other day, what did I short at? Like 210? You know, I didn't catch the exact top. And I'm glad I cut losses quickly before it spiked 30 cents against me. I lost like 10 cents instead. But it has dropped in the next 2 to 3 days. So I wasn't entirely wrong. And that, you know, I'm not trying to brag. Like, it's okay to be wrong. Some people think, oh, when you say you're on the right track, that's meaningless. No, it's not. You know, I'm constantly using, you know, being on the right track and trades, you know, recent trades, failed or successful, to learn basically, you know, these patterns and to kind of refine. So, you know, if you show me a stock like VMRI with that pattern again, I'll take knowledge from the last pump, that one that I took a loss on, and maybe I'll be a little more aggressive in holding it and maybe average up because there were more shares to short at Interactive Brokers. And even though, you know, it hit 240, the next day or 2 days later is down to 150. So I was on the right track, and I'm damn proud to be on the right track. Oftentimes I'm off by a day or two. That does not take away from my trade. That does not take away from the pattern. That gives my trade and pattern credibility in my mind. Ethan says, I have studied for 3 months and now I'm trading but cannot find my rhythm as yet. Any advice on how you found yours after your recent string of losses? Yeah, Ethan, I mean, 3 months is nothing. We all want success in like a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks or a year. This is a lifelong thing. You know, Tim Grittani, arguably the single best trader in the entire world in the past 5 years, 1,500 now into like 3.1 million. No one else in the world has done that and been able to show it trade for trade. And it took him 9 months to find his groove. So if you think that you're superhuman, Tim Grittani, and you're going to figure it all out in a third the time that he took, you're wrong. You're wrong, Ethan. You're going to need more time. And a lot of you guys need to be reminded of that. When I post the pictures of $1 million on my bed, I'm not saying this is a get-rich-quick scheme. I'm saying if you study over several months, over several years, you too can have $1 million in cash on your bed. But it takes time. Many, many people want it too quickly, and you're not willing to really learn. If you haven't found your rhythm, guess what? You're on the right track. I know it's tough. I know it sucks. I know you want to hear something better, but you need to find your patterns. And guess what? I've been trading for nearly 20 years now, and I screw up from time to time. Everyone does. Tim Grittani, even though he's at 3.1 million, I mean, there were months where he literally did nothing. This is not a 9-to-5 job where you're going to compound your income day after day, week after week, month after month. Sometimes you have to really learn about yourself, learn about the market. Certain markets will be better for trading. You know, if you're a short seller, I would be scared shitless in this market. I know there's a lot of scared short sellers. And frankly, they haven't adapted. And that's fine. You know, you don't have to adapt. They can wait for the bear market. And that's probably a few months, maybe a year or two away. And then they're going to love life again. But you cannot look at this like you're going to learn everything right away and that you have to profit every day or every week or every month. It's not an exact science. It's not, you know, your profits are not going to be linear. Your education is not going to be linear. I know it's frustrating. Trust me. As a teacher, it's frustrating that I have to tell you this. I wrote this blog post the other day. Too many things are open. Let's see. Tim Lee cites that. And load. You see, I'm on slow Wi-Fi right now. I'm actually surprised that this webinar is working. My web pages don't load, but the webinar is okay. So the internet is not an exact science. Oh my God, this is ridiculous that this webinar is not loading. This web page. There we go. Come on. You can do it. I believe in you. I see the little blue thing going. Oh, it's a few seconds away. Get excited. Holy crap. I don't have patience. I'm going to reload this. There we go. So a key trait, you need to become a millionaire. I'm going to copy and paste this in here. And the key trait is patience. It's patience. Oh, I have to name myself. The nickname is already in use. And in this, you know, blog post, I talk about two different students who randomly, literally both, one guy Facebook messaged me and another guy tweeted me within hours of each other. And this was Jeff. And he said, Tim, I finally reached 100,000 mark thanks to you. And then one of my other students, Charlie, chimed in. That's awesome. Keep it up. Soon you'll have your first 100,000 trade. And Jeff followed up saying, thanks. It's been fantastic. Lost a lot at first, then something clicked, averaging a little over 10,000 a month. So this was Jeff, and he had been a student for a year. And then my student NH, who didn't want his name released publicly, and he said, hi, Tim, what's up? I was a challenge student late 2013 into 2014. During the first year, I managed to wipe my account out 5 or 6 times, though I never stopped learning from my mistakes and from your teachings. And let me clarify this, because a lot of people have told me, how do you lose all your money 5 or 6 times? He was breaking rules, and I didn't show you, you know, we talk quite a bit. I didn't show you the follow-up messages, but he knew he was breaking rules. But he kept learning, and, you know, when you break all the rules at first, it's not hard to improve. So he gradually improved, and it took him a little time, but then he says this, I'm not looking for you to publish it, though. I have to say thank you. Today, after roughly 3 years, I hold an account of $320,000. I owe you more than you can imagine. Bought a house, bought my dream car. I just wish more people will understand that you are real. Thank you. And please do not publish it, or if you do, remove my name. Thank you, mate, for real. That's why I removed his name. Some people think that, like, oh, he's fake. I don't have any fake testimonials. These are real people. I know his name. He really was a challenge student, but he doesn't want the publicity, and that's fine. I respect that. But in both of these guys, this guy lost his account 5 or 6 times, and Jeff lost a lot at first, too. So you have to be patient, and you have to be accepting of losses at first. I know it sucks, okay? I wish I could tell you, oh, I'll just teach you everything from day one, and you'll be profitable from day one. It does not work that way. But the good news is that there is light at the end of the tunnel. It is almost impossible, no matter how bad at math you are, no matter how dumb you are, no matter how bad your internet is, if you study this stuff for 6 months or a year or 2 years at the max, it would be nearly impossible for you not to see the patterns and find your groove. So all I can say to you is, Ethan, please have patience. And I know that was a long answer, but this is such an important mindset for so many of you. I get this from so many people, whether you're 1 week in, 1 month in, you know, I don't really get it from people who are 6 or 9 months in. They usually start getting it by then, but the first few months are tough. LA Jazz says, in Tim Fundamentals Part 2, you mentioned you look at Yahoo Finance percent gainers and use that as a resource. Is it because you're expecting them to drop the next day and you're hoping to short or dip? So I am always looking at big percent gainers. And I actually have to write a blog post tomorrow about how the new Yahoo Finance sucks. I'm sorry that they changed their whole thing, but they absolutely suck now. I look at big percent gainers almost exclusively. If the catalyst is good, I want to buy it because it might have legs. Like DGI, when I bought it at $1.20, you know, let me just reinforce this here, because a lot of people see my buy of BGI at 120 and you're like, God, you left so much on the table. It was already up on the day from 50 cents a share. So the stock was already a freaking 120% mover. So when it was up like 150%, that was a lot for me to ask, because I don't normally like chasing. But I looked at it. It was a big percent mover. It had good news. And guess what? That gets me wanting to piggyback the move. The difference between that and VMRI is VMRI, you know, had the big crash from 3 all the way down to 1. Now it's 90 cents all the way up to the 2. So this 2 had doubled. This was roughly 120% winner, although it was over the course of like 2 weeks when I started shorting it the other day. And that was just because, frankly, Interactive Brokers had shares to short and I was grateful. But it was the same roughly 120% move. So why am I shorting the 120% move in VMRI, even though it was up, you know, 120% over 2 weeks, versus buying the 120% move in BGI? I'm glad these stocks roughly work the same. BGI was up on earnings, so I could piggyback it because I knew as more people would see it, the stock could spike. Again, I did not know it was going to go from 1 to 5. I thought at best it could hit 2, so I underestimated it. VMRI, when it was up 120% over 2 weeks, this is a classic number 6 from my penny stocking framework DVD. it was a potential first red day. And, you know, where was it? I was shorting it in here. And even though it finished high, I was off by a day. The next day it did have the panic. And the third day, you know, we got the nice short. Pumps towards the end, especially when they're, you know, facing resistance. I thought that this resistance here at 225 would hold, and it didn't. It went to 240, 250 actually. It broke through all this resistance. So if you were using technical analysis to short this pump, you know, theoretically thinking that it would fail at 220, 230, you were wrong. But in the grand scheme of things, you were right. So I'm looking at big percent gainers to either buy or to short sell. I don't care about big percent losers. I don't care about boring stocks. I found success focusing on big percent gainers only. Near Green says, today Stocks to Trade was updated. Maybe the problem is solved. Yes, Stocks to Trade had a big update today. I got to write a blog post about that too. Maybe tomorrow I'll just write a blog post with like 7 or 10 like FAQs. There's too much stuff going on to dedicate a whole blog post to just one subject. But yes, the new Stocks to Trade was updated. If you're having any issues, please email dev@stockstotrade.com, D-E-V, or support@stockstotrade.com. But most people like the update. We have a whole bunch of new features. Really excited for upcoming Stocks to Trade features too. Let's see. Karen Bart says, my first trade will be at the conference, just studying right now. How should I properly plan? Don't plan your first trade, okay? This is not like, you know, prom where you have to plan a specific day to trade. Wait for the best setups to trade. What if there's an amazing setup a week before the conference and you're like, no, I can't trade for one more week. That's insane. Learn the best setups. Right now, you know, we have, by the way, if you go to traderandinvestorsummit.com, we have just 2 seats left for the early bird pricing. Then it's going to be gone. Just FYI, and then the price is roughly $1,000 for 3 days, which is still a good deal. But right now, you know, it's $297 for 3 days, which is ridiculous. We don't make any money on the conference, by the way. It's all for networking and to help you guys. We don't make any money on Stocks to Trade either. In fact, we're actually down 6 figures since we started developing this thing. So just want you guys to understand there's a lot of misconceptions like, oh, Tim just does this to make money. Actually, no. I mean, there's a lot of ways that I could do this to make much more money. And we don't do that because the way that I found my business has grown the best is to give you guys the most tools and to make the most successful students so that you give me the best testimonials and tell your friends and tell your social media. And that's how business grows. So I want to make that perfectly clear. And I guess I'll put that in tomorrow's blog post too. But the question was, how do I properly plan for my first trade in 2.5 months? You know, again, I would not wait necessarily 2.5 months. Maybe you won't be ready for 4 months. Maybe you'll be ready in a month. Don't have specific ideas like that. One of my students, Jane, just passed $100,000 in profits. And that's awesome. Let me actually see. I want you to see if we can. Jane Yule. This was my student, Jane. Oh, this loaded quickly. And she said, it's official today. I'm up above my $100,000 profit mark. Never would have thought this possible. Thank you, Timothy Sykes, for starting tools. And this was just 5 days ago. And that was awesome. Until she followed up by some other stuff. She started thanking everybody. Sorry. She had a blog post like, almost at $100,000 in profits, I can taste it. Now she's been posting some of her trades. But she also posted one comment that I didn't like. And this applies to you guys too. She trades some non-penny stocks too. So don't feel like you have to be like, oh, I have to trade the same stocks as Tim. Find your groove. She posts a lot on Twitter. But there was one comment that I wanted to go over. I don't have to talk that loud. Sorry. Let me see. Oh my God, she posts so much. Oh, she's going to be there at the conference too, by the way. She says, if you want to network, go there and you can meet Jane in person. Ah, this was the comment. So she said, I'm looking forward to the next 150,000, the new goal, and then in 250,000 by January 1st. And I said, remember not to try to force it. Just take it one trade at a time. So it's, you know, it's fun to pass 100,000. It's fun to pass a million. It's fun to pass 3 million. But it's not a linear process. You cannot try and set these goals and then you start forcing trades to try and get to those goals. Trading has to be very natural. And I continue to believe this. And I know it's tough to do because you want to trade every day. You want to like, okay, let me change babysitters for the day. Let me take work off and I'll trade today. You cannot make good plays happen when you want them. You can't schedule them on a certain day. You can't schedule them in a certain hour. You can't schedule, when bad trades will pop up. You have to react to the market. So by Jane passing $100,000, that's awesome. She's been a challenge student for a little over a year. But do not try to force these 150,000 or 250,000. It's nice to have big goals eventually, but don't try and put timestamps on them. By January 1st, 2017, by January 1st, 2017, she might still be at 100,000. And does that mean that she's a failure? No. Maybe she took some time off. She's a new mom. Maybe she, you know, screwed up on a trade. Maybe she's, you know, just focusing on studying for a few months. Don't feel that you have to make all this money right at first. It comes over time when you're least prepared. You know, I skipped my college graduation because there was a trade. And my parents and my grandparents were sitting in the hot New Orleans sun as they called my name twice, and I wasn't there. But I made a trade, and it paid for basically a semester of college. So it was worth it to skip my college graduation. Now, that sucks. You know, I missed some important stuff in my life, but you don't have to take it to that level. I'm just using that as an example of the best trades will come whenever they want, not on your timeline. So Karen asked, you know, how do you prepare right now? Just study, you know, watch my penny stocking part de, ideally spikeability, and ideally how to make millions too. Those are some of my newest DVDs. Justice says, Tim, will FinViz and OTC markets work well enough for me to find stocks? I would just be in the chat room. FinViz is decent. OTC markets, I guess they have big percent gainers. I use OTC markets just for SEC filings. But just go in the chat room. You have access to the chat room. REN, would you dip by the stock since you know the stock is heavily shorted? I'm not touching REN. It's an energy play that's going supernova. And as we saw with SGY, I have no idea what's going to happen. The dude says, CNR shot up this morning on a short squeeze. It held up all day with volume. From your experience, what do you think it could do tomorrow? In this market, it's a potential spiker. It's a potential re-spiker for sure. So I'll be, you know, when I do my watch list tonight, I'll say this is a potential buy. It could potentially go supernova like this again. It'll probably fail considering it's day two, but it's always worth a shot. You know, the risk reward in this market so heavily favors buying as opposed to shorting. It's unreal. Crassy says Yahoo Finance has a new layout today. Yes, it's absolutely terrible. They are incredibly ignorant. It's unreal how bad it is. And it's unreal how E-Trade shut down ClearStation.com. It's proof that the two largest financial properties have no idea what traders want. It's alarmingly pathetic. But it's good news because now I'm in the space and I do know what traders want. And it's just crazy how wrong these big companies can be. But that's the good news, you know? Former big companies fail all the time and startups succeed all the time. And I believe that, you know, my education company has the finger on the pulse of the most traders. And so we can provide you the tools and layouts and education that you need. That's also why CNBC's ratings are at multi-decade lows. Kramer does not make money. Study after study has shown that he wins roughly 35 to 40% of the time. That's not good enough. It might be entertaining, but it's not going to make you money. And so you're going to turn the TV off or change the channel when he comes on. Let's see. When you get sideways action, such as CNR, what are the signs to go long or short? I encourage you to watch my video lesson from last August. Look at this. This is how crazy my catalog of videos is. Let's go to, we're in the challenge. We do video lessons. So I have 4,000 video lessons, but you can use the tools to see like which ones are short squeeze, supernova, stuff like that. But I just happen to know that last August I did a video lesson. Let me go to like page, what would be last August? Page 9. Nope, that only goes to December. Damn, I do a lot of video lessons. You better be watching them all, even though I know you're not. Pathetic. Page 15. This was last July. Let's go to page 14. Last August. Oh, wait, I'm into July again. Page 13. You should be watching all of these video lessons. If you guys want to be prepared, you can watch all of them. And FYI, even though there's 4,000 video lessons, they're in 5-minute segments. So we're talking about 300 hours. So if you put in 2 hours a day, we're talking a few months. If you put in 5 hours a day, we're not talking very long. What is that? 5 hours a day? 60 days, 2 months. I know it's a lot, but you're studying history. All right, where was it? AQXP was amazing. I was in Amsterdam. Where is my Amsterdam play? Let me do a Google search. Tim Sykes, Amsterdam trade. Let's see, I was on Instagram too. Here it is. Good morning from Amsterdam. So I remember this view, because I woke up to a nearly $10,000 profit on Ford. This was August 12th. Okay. Let's see. Do I really not have a video lesson in here? Is it right here? Yeah.
Really mean to go up that much? Are there computer algorithms?
This is it on Ford.
Is there a short squeeze? Is it a mistaken order? I don't care what the reasoning is. What I do care.
So this was the same kind of ridiculous spike. When I was in Amsterdam and I made nearly 10 grand with that beautiful view, and Ford went from, you know, a dollar up to three, and it came down and it actually bounced quite nicely into the close. And I was dip buying it in here in the 130s. It was closing in the 170s. It actually went up the next morning to the 230s. So it was a fantastic trade. And that is my answer to what I think about CNR tomorrow. Although I don't think, you know, Ford had good earnings. CNR did not have good earnings. So, but that would be best case scenario. Let's see. What do I think about EXAS? Again, it's not my pattern. Karen says, thank you for inspiring me out of my comfort zone. I just want to focus on earnings and contract winners. Awesome. Whatever makes you comfortable. Zach says, I just started the challenge. I have a lot of my money tied up in other stocks like UVXY. They are about to do a 5-to-1 stock split. What should I do? Not my pattern. I have no idea about UVXY. You know, first of all, this is an ETF. This is not a stock. I don't like trading ETFs. You're betting on the market as a whole. You can see it's clearly going down. So I hope at least you're short UVXY. But that's not my pattern. So I don't know what to do. That's like asking, you know, Tiger Woods for marriage advice or Martha Stewart for legal advice. That's not their specialties. So don't do it. What are some good sources of penny stock news? I mean, this is what Stocks to Trade is all about. We've put in all of the news, all of the fundamentals, all of the chart, all of the scans into one platform. Sticker says, the most important part that Tim Grittani said in your webinar was that Tim Grittani started to become profitable after using just one and only one strategy until he mastered it, then the next. Yeah, you know, I mean, you could try one strategy. You can try two strategies. Just start trying at least something. And ideally, you know, you're utilizing my vast resource of video lessons, webinars, and DVDs as your guide, because I'm basically a glorified history teacher. And I've given you the history of these patterns over the past, you know, 5-10 years. In the next 5 to 10 years, my history lessons are going to be even more comprehensive. Oh, you bought UVXY. I mean, then you go, it doesn't matter what my pattern is. Rule number one, cut losses quickly. Because now you're emotionally involved in it. So whether it comes back or not, it's tough for you to think clearly. So your odds of success are bad. First of all, the chart is terrible. Second of all, your odds are bad because you're emotionally involved. And third of all, you didn't cut losses quickly. So you're 0 for 3. I would cut losses quickly because it's just money tied up, wasted in a low odds pattern. I know that's not what you want to hear, but if I ever have a big loss, you know, one time I didn't log into my E-Trade account for a few days and I freaking stupidly had a stock FREEF in it that I forgot some of the shares got executed a few days before and I was down like 50%. It was, you know, a few $100 loss. And did I think about if it was going to come back or not? Not in the least. I took my medicine, I cut my loss, and the stock continued dropping. So I felt pretty good. This was FR. Hey, it was kind of the same chart as what you're in. Look at this. FREF is now down to a penny. I think I was trying to buy it in here when the shippers were running, and I made some money on it. But oh man, no, it was in here because they had just changed their ticker. Anyways, it was running here, and I had held it accidentally through these like 3 days, and I was in at like 70 cents. And it was down to like 40 cents a share. You can see this on Profitly. And I cut my losses quickly. And now it's a penny a few months later. And it never came back at all. So I don't regret that decision. Even if it had come back, I wouldn't regret the decision. When I'm in a trade that is not good odds or that I don't feel comfortable or specifically is not my choosing, like that one, you get out. Aside from Stocks to Trade, what are other scanning software? I don't use any other scanning software because no other scanning software is made for low-price stock traders. We used to partner with EquityFeed, but they could not handle the number of requests of features that I wanted. You know, they're a good company, but I'm high maintenance, okay? You can ask anybody. I demand perfection, and I demand ridiculous amounts of hard work. You know, I was a number one tennis player on my high school team, and I was not the captain because if I had been voted captain, I would have run those little runts into the ground with my work ethic. And that's not exactly a fun way to be. So am I a leader? I guess not. Do I demand perfection? Hell yes. Does it work? Hell yes. So that's what you get with me. And that's what Stocks to Trade is all about. And in the coming months, you will see that as we will have more features than any other platform combined. Conscious Warrior says got killed on TTMP when they approved and it sold off on news. I didn't play the price action. Eh, you know, I mean, you got to cut losses quickly. That's not an option. Sticker says Tokyo airport trading. Yeah, I mean, sometimes I trade. I've actually done really well in the Hong Kong airport for whatever reason. A few times I made money from Hong Kong. So I think I'm going to be going back there this summer. So maybe I'll give a webinar from the Hong Kong airport. CoTrader says having trouble deciding when to enter a trade. Any suggestions? Sure, CoTrader. You know, wait for big percent gainers. Wait for plays with good catalysts and good volume. And look for breakouts. When I was buying BGI the other day, you know, again, in this chart, you're not going to really be able to see it. But when I was buying it, it had already, you can see a little red candle right here, right? Let me move my mouse. So you can see there were two red candles. This is a 1 minute chart. So for several minutes, it had already spiked to 140 when I dip bought it at 120-ish. So it was a risk dip buying it. But at the same time, it gave me a nice little 20 cents of upside. If for some reason it went back to 140 and double topped, I would still have some profits. And as it turned out, you know, it broke out, but just barely to the 150s. It wasn't a very convincing breakout, and that got me out. But then it just kept going. So for me, massive volume, massive percent gain, and I went in with a thesis. Alex says, Tim, I build my watch list in the night before, but I realize that maybe a pre-market watch list would be more effective. Do both. Stop trying to slack, Alex. You know, I make my nightly watch list of plays that I'm looking at, recent patterns, recent news. But then pre-market, there's more news and more percent gainers. And you'll see me pre-market. You'll see a lot of other traders talking about potential plays pre-market. Steve says, time zone totally screws everything up. I might be moving to Australia and would have to be up most of the night. Welcome to my life. Well, not that bad when I'm on West Coast. Right now I'm in Miami, but West Coast kind of sucks for trading. You know, you do what you got to do. You know, the U.S. market is by far the most volatile and the best for trading. How can you tell if a company is a pump? You know, you can Google it. You can look at their press releases and see hyperbole. You can do a Twitter search with the ticker, and you'll see a lot of various promoters talking about it. You can ask Michael Good or myself or Tim Grittani in the chat room. Sometimes people do a blog post. Michael Good does blog posts about pumps, and he shows the mailers, stuff like that. Smile and Shine says, okay, Sykes and Grittani both say you should not be scared when trading, and Good says you should always be scared, and if you aren't, there is something wrong with you. Mixed info. I mean, I trade scared. I have a whole DVD where I talk in a Mickey Mouse voice, and I pretend I'm a castrated choir boy trader. I don't know what you say, I should not be scared. I mean, you should be somewhat scared, but you shouldn't be uncomfortable. I think that's the difference that you're looking for. I'm always scared of potential loss. So you'll see me exit trades quickly, sometimes too quickly. You'll see me protect. You'll see me, you know, just trade like a coward. but because I know that I'm going to trade like a coward, it's not that scary. So I trade scared, but I'm not scared. And I know that's a subtlety, but that's the truth. You know, if you're not willing to cut losses quickly, if you're just like, oh, I'm just going to hold and hope. Let me see what happens. Let's see if this Sykes character is real. And you just hold and you're down, you know, maybe you're up 20% and you don't take profits and you're down 30% and you don't take losses. And you're like, ah, Sykes sucks. Well, yeah, because you're breaking the rules. No different than, you know, you would say a Ferrari or a Lamborghini sucks if you're going 200 miles an hour in a 35 mile an hour zone. You got to pay attention to the rules. So I trade scared in order to be more comfortable. I trade scared so that I'm not scared to trade. Ooh, I like that quote. I don't think I've ever said that out loud. I trade scared. Wait, how did it go? Shoot, I forgot it. Ugh, I'm going to have to listen to the webinar replay. I trade scared so that I'm not scared to trade. Ooh, that gives me shivers. I want that on my tombstone. That's amazing. I have never put that together. Smile and shine. Thank you for asking that question. Hold up. I trade scared so I'm not scared to trade. Well, I'm keeping that. That's amazing. And that's the truth. Let's see. NTKS says, I wish Stocks to Trade had a mobile app. Welcome to my life. We're working on it. It takes time. It took us like nearly 2 years to build Stocks to Trade. Lauren says, with your small account, do you ever trade more than 15%? Sometimes, but not usually. Sticker says, Tim Sykes, Tim Grittani, Michael Good all made millions without Stocks to Trade. It just reduces your basic research. If you don't want to spend more money after this, start as them. I would disagree there. You know, Stocks to Trade, I know it costs money, but again, understand I'm not doing it for the money. Data is expensive, and good data and good information is expensive. And, you know, $100 a month, $150 a month is really not the end of the world. If you're trying to become a millionaire, you've got to invest in your education. And if you want to cheap it out, you know, I know a lot of people that don't want to do the challenge because they're like, oh, I'll just learn on my own. And then they come back 6 months, 9 months later, down 10, 20, 30, 50, 100 grand, way more than any of my challenges could ever cost. And they didn't even learn the right lessons because the market taught them and the market isn't exactly a great teacher. Do not skimp out, okay? When we have new tools, they're there to help you. You know, when the car is invented, you don't say, oh, this car, you know, we didn't used to get around in cars. I'm just going to use my horse and buggy. You know, use new technology. It's created for you, not for you to ignore. Let's see. Karen says, cutting losses quickly is what I intend to do. When is it getting away from me? When do I know to cut it off? When it drops 10 cents. Well, I mean, it depends what the stock price is. If it's a dollar stock, 10 cents a share is a, you know, 10% loss. If it's a 20 cent stock and it drops 10 cents, it's a 50% loss. So for me, I like cutting losses. You can look at all of my trades. You know, sometimes I lose 1, 2, 3, 4%. That's it. I really don't like giving it 10%. All right, let's see. Level 2 DVD is a bit funny when you're sleep drunk. Yeah, I mean, level 2 DVD, I pounded through that one night. I pulled an all-nighter. Pops Pinker says, I'm a bit confused exactly what price action is. Can you give me an example? It's the chart. This is price action. The price, and it's moving. It's acting up. It's acting down. This is price action. So for me, price action is king. If I'm buying a stock, you know, I bought BGI at 120-ish. My goal was for it to break 140 convincingly. And it went to 150, but it was a really kind of weak breakout. And at this point, the stock is up 150%. I'm thinking, okay, I have a 20% profit. Let me just take them. So I did. And then it shoots up another, you know, 300, 400%. Price action is going in with a thesis, namely, you know, get buying off the high and expecting that the high is going to get taken out. Or sometimes, you know, like TWER, you know, going into a stock and sometimes leaving disappointed, or not TWI, BGI today, you know, buying it in the 270s, knowing that I chased it a little bit, but being a little disappointed with this double top at 3-ish. And then dip buying it and being a little disappointed that it couldn't break 270. Disappointment is part of the game. Tim, I want to piggyback on my question. When you decide to make a trade, do you watch the level 2 of the chart? Hell yes. I watch the level 2 and the chart. Tricob says, funny screen name. When you're looking for shares to short, do you call your broker or their links? So I used to call in my brokers. Now I just, you know, if they have shares to short, they have it. You know, for me as a teacher, it does me no good if I find shares to short and no one else can. So even if I call in and maybe me and like 5 other people can find shares to short, it's just going to suck for most students. So I've learned to only really short when there's a lot of shares available so that, you know, students can see and learn in real time. Am I still strict regarding according to my Timline DVD? Yeah, you know, I don't really trade midday, but again, in this aggressive market, I'm going to be more aggressive. So you have to adapt everything to the market. Right now, everything's flying, but I prioritize the market open and the market close. Tim G talks about his bread and butter, and so do you. Are these easily found by scanning on Stocks to Trade? Yes. Jojo says, do you still use Arca on level two if you have an issue with executions? I don't care about routing. I don't trade with a big account, and most of you guys don't either, so I wouldn't worry about routing. You know, this is what, you know, people who trade hundreds of times a day or with big accounts care about. Make a Decision says, do I use moving averages? No, I don't use any moving averages. I think they're absolutely useless. Justice says, so the chat room is the best source of finding hot stocks if you can't get stocks to trade. Correct. That's what I think right now. That might change, but that's right now. Let's see. Deep says, I equate the skill to learning an instrument, time, dedication, practice. I agree 100%. Twisted English says, cheers, Tim. I get discouraged by the scale of learning in this industry. Listening to you gets me amped. Yeah, I mean, part of my job is just reminding you of what actually works. You know, Tim Grittani at the end of our webinar was like, Tim Sykes, I don't want to offend you, but I wasn't looking to, you know, be the next you. And I was like, I'm not offended. It's more important just that you see that we're real. It's more important that you see what we've accomplished. There's so much negativity out there. There's so many scams out there. There's so many fakers out there. I'm not always going to be right. Tim Grittani is not always going to be right. We could lose on any trade. We could be wrong in any trade. But if you follow the guidelines that we're sharing with you, it increases your odds. And it's very difficult to lose big if you follow the rules. Although some people try to lose big, not on purpose, but they just break the rules. Lauren says, when you do go long, what determines your small account trade size? I mean, a lot of the stuff that I'm trading lately is just speculative because we're in a speculative market. You know, there's not a SYNC $100 million a year deal every day. And also, you know, we're deep into this bull market, so it's tough for me to be aggressive buying earnings winners because I think that a lot of these stocks are fully priced already. And so we see a lot of earnings winners fail lately. And that's just because we're, you know, in this 8-year bull market. Karen says, you are the real deal. So blessed to have found you. Thank you. Let's see. Chart Reaction says, before I found Tim, I lost $3,400 on a pot stock. It felt like crap, but here we can reverse old mindsets. Yeah, you know, pot stocks wiped a lot of people out. Read this link that I'm about to post. This is an article in Men's Journal that I did nearly 2 years ago, and it was me versus this weed stock promoter, and, you know, he was just totally wrong about everything, and so many people believe in marijuana and how it's changing the business. And guess what? The patterns are the exact same as every other pump and dump. So I was short selling and I was on the right and he was buying and he and his followers lost everything. So don't ever believe in a sector or anybody who tells you, you know, losses don't matter. Just keep holding. You know, that's just ridiculous. How do I adjust to getting up so damn early? I don't. I'm a grumpy bastard sometimes. Tim, when you have your watch list set the following day, do you mainly watch those stocks? And if they aren't doing what you plan, what do you do next? Good question. Then I look for, you know, I look in the chat room for other plays. I look for new percent gainers. I look for new news. I'm always on the lookout. You know, even if the stocks from my overnight watch list are doing exactly what I want, I never stop looking. That's not to say that I'm by a computer 24/7. You know, this afternoon I'm in Miami. I'm hanging out with my family. It's my mom's birthday tomorrow. So everybody wish her a happy birthday tomorrow. But, you know, you have to keep it in the back of your mind that a big play could be just around the corner. Now, obviously, as we head into July and August, these are technically the two slowest months of the year. But as we see with BGI, I mean, there's still plays that are going supernova. So I might be trading smaller and trading less frequently right now, but I'm still on the lookout. Nakama says, for the profitable traders in the chat, what finally clicked when you started to become profitable? I'll answer that, probably because it's when you find a pattern that works. You know, my little 12,000 into 1.65 million in the first 4 years sounds awesome, but describing it in one sentence is inaccurate. To go from 12,000 to 1.65 million in 4 years, I mean, my first 700,000 was exclusively buying penny stock breakouts. You can read this in my book, An American Hedge Fund. And then, you know, that was the first the last few months of 99, or pretty much all of 99. And then, you know, the first 4 months of 2000, where I had a roughly $800,000. And then the last eight months of the year 2000, I lost $10,000. I made no money whatsoever because there were no more penny stock breakouts. and then 2001, 2002, I made, you know, roughly another million or so by short selling. So you have to adapt to the market and learn different patterns. It's not just one pattern that's going to do it. And if you learn one pattern that's working, that's cool. Work it until it stops working. Let's see. When doing a scam, what do you look for? Minimum volume, maximum 200,000 to 8 million. Yeah, you can call it that. Let's see. Is the conference tax deductible? I don't know. You're going to have to ask your accountant. That's a different answer for everybody. The dude says stocks to trade has not crashed once and works wonderfully. Good. I'm glad. The dude abides. Oh, maybe E-Trade Pro didn't crash. Yeah, I mean, stocks to trade does crash sometimes. I'll give you that. It's brand new software, so I'm not claiming it's perfect. But we're going to keep making it better. As you'll see, I'm a perfectionist. DVDs is a ton to cover. Video lessons are second priority. Well, video lessons are done like chronologically. You know, I review what's happened in the past day or two or the past week. DVDs are more comprehensive. So they're different skill sets of learning. And I think, you know, that's cool. Some videos are 25 minutes. But if you notice the way that those video lessons are tagged, they're counted as five separate video lessons because everything is in 5 minute increments so that I can understand the whole, you know, library time. Sticker says one thing we have learned about history is that it repeats itself over and over again. I agree. And that's why I'm basically a glorified, you know, history teacher. Is the chat room on Profitly? Yes. If you go to Profitly, /profiting. That is the chat room. Tim, I'm sorry I'm in the office. I don't know if you answered the question about the night watch list. Again, create a watch list at night and then create another watch list with pre-market movers and pre-market news. You can't cheat hard work. You can't just say, oh, I'm just going to create one watch list. You can do that, but you might miss some plays. You know, be in the chat room at 9 a.m. Eastern, and for a half hour, just look for new plays. You don't have to wake up at like 7 in the morning. You don't have to be like an athlete and, you know, eat freaking white scrambled eggs and grapefruit. You're not training to be a ballerina. You can eat whatever you want, but try to be there 30 minutes before the market opens. When I'm in LA, can we get a group and go to the Laugh Factory? I don't go out at night in LA, as my fiance can attest. I'm really boring because I have to get up at, you know, 5 or 6 in the morning. So for me, I'm not good at early rising. That means that I'm not going to be fun at night. I don't know if they have midday stuff, but that's all I'm good for. Let's see. Aren't all the news and tools like scanners and level two on E-Trade Pro? Why is Stocks to Trade better? Well, for one, Stocks to Trade, you know, is made for traders. E-Trade Pro is made for investors. So Stocks to Trade is in the process. On some tickers, you'll find better data, but soon it'll have better data on all low price stocks. Sometimes E-Trade Pro does not even pick up a stock that Stocks to Trade does. Secondly, Stocks to Trade has many more news sources built in, and most importantly, my 40 plus custom scanners on Stocks to Trade. And soon Stocks to Trade will also have paper trading and the ability to integrate with multiple brokerage accounts, which E-Trade Pro will not have. So very exciting times, but it takes time to build. Tim, I'm wondering how come you didn't buy some of the hot plays in the last days, BLFS, CDTI, NETE. It hasn't been good. Yeah, I mean, it's tough in July and August. And, you know, I haven't really been on my game the past few days. Then I was traveling. You know, I had to go back and watch my Spikeability DVD. So I'm taking one or two trades a day, you know, but I'm not going to force it until I see something great. CDTI, you know, I chased a bit. NETE, I wasn't even tempted. The news wasn't that good. BLFS didn't have good enough price action. Pro Touch Rehab says, how can you focus on multiple plays? I set alerts on where to buy, but my head spins at trying to focus on too many stocks. I usually only have one stock at a time. I don't know how people handle 5, 6, 8 stocks. I don't get it. I don't want to get it. I'm you know, a one stock kind of guy. I focus. Sometimes I take two stocks, but very rarely will you ever see me have three stocks, and never will I have four stocks. End of the day, volume sucked on BGI. Yeah, I mean, it was a failed spiker, so I'm not interested in it. Where do I find good pre-market information? In the chat room, people are sharing big percent winners and news. Do I like E-Trade or Interactive Brokers more? It goes back and forth. Interactive Brokers has been better lately, but E-Trade sometimes gets better. If you want one-on-one, we have that option too. Just email admin@timothysykes.com. You know, we have Market Mastery too, where I trade with roughly 7 to 10 students in person. We have multiple options for you guys to learn. In your DVDs, you refer to securing shares to short before you actually short. Does that mean that you make sure they're short shares to short? Correct. Do you encourage investing in marijuana stocks? No. Hell no. It's way too sketchy of an industry, you know. It is very far from certain. And, you know, a good example is Massroots, MSRT, which is like a wannabe Facebook for weed. And they applied to be on the NASDAQ, and the NASDAQ actually rejected them. That was right in here. So very, very tough industry to be invested in. But trading it, that's fine. Will the conference be available as live stream? I think, but I'm not 100% sure. It's much better if you come to the conference in person. Anyways, guys, I got to get going, but thank you again for joining me on this Q&A. I will send you guys a watch list later tonight. I will see you in the chat room tomorrow. Remember, do not feel pressure to trade. Do not feel pressure to trade big. Do not feel pressured at all by your family and friends who probably think that you're crazy for even wanting to trade penny stocks, and they think that I'm the Wolf of Wall Street. Keep learning. If you have any doubts whatsoever, study all of the video lessons and DVDs, especially by, you know, not my first millionaire student, my second millionaire student, Tim Grittani. Michael Good's DVD is amazing too. Learn how to read SEC filings. He's my first millionaire student. just want to repeat this because no one else has this. So there's a lot of negativity, a lot of critics, but they frankly just don't have the success that I have had as a teacher. Forget my trading success, but as a teacher, I think I'm really improving and I have a few upcoming millionaire students. And I know money is not everything, but it's a good way to show that you know your stuff if you can make $1 million from hardly anything. So really do not trust anybody who does not show all their trades publicly. There's so many scammers out there after this 8-year bull market. You know, you can get rid of them, or you can basically say, you know, just cut through their BS by asking two questions. Show me your entire public track record, ideally multi-year or multi-decade, and show me your millionaire students. And I don't think there's anybody else who can you know, match up. And that's why I'm very proud. But at the same time, I have to remain humble because, you know, you're just one bad trade away from nothingness and failure. So I'll end by the quote by saying, I trade scared, so I'm not scared to trade. Thank you and have a good night.
My name is Tim Sykes and I teach people to trade stocks. I am a self-made multimillionaire.
So this is the ideal trade that I'm going to talk about. I want you guys to understand every single aspect of this trade.